And then I remember I was in high school and I was just bombing, man. And I had no direction whatsoever what I was going to do. And grade 12 is coming up and you're supposed to know if you're going to go to university, college. It's like, I'm lucky I'm making it to class today, man. I don't know what I'm going to do. So they're like, well, maybe you're an extroverted kid. Maybe you'd like to join some theater. You should be in the theater. You're so extroverted. I was like, no way, man. It's hard enough wearing helmets. I ain't putting leotards on. That's one step too far right there, you know. It's like, well, not all theaters like that. There's a lot of different kinds of theater. And he took we're from Hamilton. He took a school trip to Toronto to see Second City. I never heard of Second City. This is when SCTV was just getting started. But I'm sitting in the audience, and I'm watching, and on stage is John Candy, Martin Short, Catherine O'Hara. They were just young actors at this time, you know. And I was like, oh, my God, Improvisation. This is fantastic. This is great. That's what I want to do. I want to do that. I want to do that. And the teacher's going, okay, great. Well, you know, you go to theater school, and this is like, oh, you said school again. Kind of blew it for me there for a while, you know. But I was so excited because improvisation was, they're just making it up as they go along. And no one's telling them to shut up. This is pretty good. And they're getting paid. This is good. Oh, this is good. This is good. So my fiance, who's soon to be my wife, and I thought, we'll open our own club, because you know, no one can fire me then. I had no self-esteem whatsoever, because those are really the things kids need, ADHD kids need to thrive, and to survive and possibly thrive as an adult, is just friendship, self-esteem, success in a direction, and success academically. And one kind of leads to the other. I had none of those. You know, so you're just kind of floating alone. I really didn't think anyone would find me funny or that they would actually ever hire me, that kind of thing. So what I did was we both went up going to college for hotel and restaurant because we were going to open our own place. We'd figure out how to do this on the business side. And at night, I worked at Second City on the door as the night manager, watching the show every night of what would be going on. So one day, the director comes in and they're having a national touring company, which is anybody can audition anywhere in the city for a place in this company who will go out and do Second City shows around the country. Oh man, that's great, you know. So he says to me, can you set the theater up tomorrow for 200 people to come in and do this? And I said, great, yeah, okay. Can I get on that list? And he said, you? Because to them, I was just the doorman. They had no idea what I was thinking, what I was afraid to say aloud. And he went, yeah, it's, anybody can come. He puts me on the list, okay, great. So I show up the next day, true enough, like just jammed with people. And what they would do is they'd say, okay, you five, come on up here on stage. And they would do just like the group did beforehand, play some games like that. And they'd say, okay, great, sit down, next six, come up. And they would do this and say, okay, you two stay, you two four down. And they did this all afternoon till finally there was only two spots available. There was myself and another guy on stage. He went, okay, great, everyone else can go, thank you very much. And we got the job. And I'd never been on a stage in my life. I was just an extroverted loud guy. And suddenly he's like, what? I just got hired to be an actor? Oh no, my fiance's gonna kill me. She's not gonna like this at all. The other guy, he was like a 16-year-old kid. Mike Myers, you ever hear him? Yeah. Mike was there that day and he got hired as well. So I don't know whatever happened to him. I'm sure he's fine. But it was improvisation that brought us all together. It was incredible. Like at that time, kids in the hall were at that audition. You know, it was just jammed with people of that era who were working, and I got the gig. I couldn't believe it. Suddenly I was, well, thank you, but I didn't know what to do about it. I was there for like 2 years having a great time. Audiences were enjoying it. I was enjoying it. And then, but the producer, she wasn't all that keen on me. The director and everybody thought I was okay, but she wasn't all that keen on me. And she called me up to her office one day and said, you know, I know you think you're pretty special, but you're not. You're not. You're just kind of loud, you know. I think this is probably the end of the road for you. You know, it's been fun, but you know, when this show ends up, that'll probably be enough for you. And I was just heartbroken. I was devastated. She goes, I know what you're thinking, that someone's going to walk in here, hand you a TV show, and you're going to have a big celebrity life. No, that's not going to happen to you. You're just not one of those people. And because of my self-esteem, it was like, poof, man, she just nailed me. I was gone. I was like, okay, yeah, I guess so. Whatever, you know, I was 12 years old again, and all those years of success were just gone in one line. That's how fragile you are. You think you're strong, but it's still there, because I was undiagnosed at this point. I didn't know that kind of how vulnerable I could actually be and how hurt I would get by that. So I'm just doing the show, and 2 weeks later, Steve Smith, who played Red Green, came into the theater to just watch the show, and I was doing the Harold character in the Second City show at the time. And he thought, oh my God, that's insane. You know, I got this new show coming up. Do you want to try this thing called Red Green? So, yes, long story much shorter, 15 years go by, right? Great success, wonderful show, worldwide success, everything's great. And the weird thing, and I stopped and thought about it later, was that's everything that happened to me, including I've been given awards, I've performed in front of prime ministers and princes and traveled the world, and it's been amazing. But someone told me it would never happen to me. And 2 weeks later, it exactly happened. Someone walked in and handed me a show. The exact thing that she said would never happen to me happened. An authority figure told me, so she must be right, which proved to me at that point, nobody knows nothing. Don't let anybody tell you what you can and can't do. They don't know a thing. Just because we're a little vulnerable that way, you don't have to listen to it. You know yourself better. Maybe they can be right in some cases, you can be stronger in certain areas, but overall, they don't have a clue. Nobody does. So don't let your ego or your spirits be pricked by that.